Preparing students to demonstrate mastery of math state standards can feel like a dull, unending cycle of equations and practice problems. Unengaged, frustrated students can weigh on teacher confidence and lead to uncertainty about overall achievement. Two Ivy League-trained engineers observed this struggle and created a way to transform how students learn the fundamentals of math. Through the innovative Accoletics math program, EDA has helped more than 400,000 students achieve success on state-administered math tests and transformed the academic strategies and performance of schools nationwide. Accoletics' uniquely designed supplemental materials and tools are well-aligned to your state standards and provide a clear path to exceed state proficiency standards. Through ongoing professional development, you will uncover common challenges and activate solutions that promise to improve student achievement in your school. By partnering with EDA and choosing Accoletics, you can start to see an unprecedented return on your investment in as little as one school year. Don't procrastinate on giving your teachers the tools to help students achieve their highest math potential. To learn how you can dramatically improve classroom instruction and learning, test scores, and student confidence, call, email, or visit Accoletics online today.
When daily tasks become too painful, it's time for change. Let our pain management and wellness practice, Valentine Integrative Health, elevate your quality of life and ease your discomfort. Visit us at valentineintegrativehealth.com and start your journey to a fuller life.
And welcome, welcome, welcome. We're back at it.
I missed you guys.
Ooh, man.
Yeah.
I had a procedure today, and it didn't mess me up. What messed me up was, let me tell you something, fat habits, bad fat habits messed me up.
Okay.
I didn't eat because I had the blood drawn. And you know what I did? As soon as I got done, I went to McDonald's.
Yeah.
And ate too much. Now I feel terrible.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes, terrible.
Well, what an introduction. Welcome to the Allison and Marc podcast, Married in Media. We are two Gen X media pros who happen to be married with three grown children. Damn. Here we talk about everything from politics to pop culture, and boy, do we have a lot of pop culture today with a little bit of humor and a whole lot of love. And I'm really sorry you don't feel well.
I like that, babe. I like how you put that together. You're something else. A talent. Babe was cracking on me yesterday because she felt like I was very touchy-feely during the workout.
Yeah.
But babe, I just think what happens is you're so beautiful. And more than that, you're just a great wife and a great friend.
This reminds me of the Red Table Talk when they were talking about the Jada's entanglement. And then Will, because I read Jada's book. Did y'all read Jada's book when it was out?
No, because nobody did.
Okay, well, I did. And you remember, but everybody remembers the Red Table Talk. Yes. With the entanglement. Well, turns out, it turns out that, you know, they had this open relationship and Will said, well, he wanted to join her on the table to talk about this, and he flipped it. And basically became the victim when he knew everything that was going on. Yeah,
he was never a victim.
And he was never a victim. So
and he never said,
he never said, yeah, we already knew this. So yes. That's what it seems like now.
Well, babe, no, it's not going that way because we didn't have any entanglements.
No, we didn't have any entanglements.
One time in Miami.
But I forgave you. And so now we've moved on.
So babe, while you're on the Will Smith thing.
So we have a lot. Like, so we weren't with you last week, and we also have a health update for Marc while he was getting this blood work, because you've been very transparent about your health journey. Yes. So I want to talk about that. But we couldn't be with you. You had some things to do last week, so I have a whole list. I kept sending you topics like, I want to talk about this, that, and the third. So you know, we love Martin Lawrence. Martin and Will Smith are coming out with Bad Boys. Right. And then there was this press conference with Martin Lawrence, and it seemed like something.
Oh, that's what I forgot. That's
That's what you were talking about.
No. I just remembered it now.
Yeah.
Did you watch it? Did he get stumbled up?
Did he stumble? It just seemed like his delivery was really slow. And
people were concerned after they saw the press conference because they thought Martin was struggling.
Yeah.
And so I didn't actually get to the struggle part.
Yeah.
There was a struggle part.
He was just speaking very slowly as if like he was going through like some sort of a health challenge or what have you. So it was sad.
And Martin never really tell us exactly what his health challenge is, because obviously to me he's bloated. It's something physical, but he's never really talked about it.
But he made a whole movie.
Right, but I'm just saying, I wonder why he just never said, hey, what happened? For those who want to know, because you know who doesn't have that at all? Is damn Eddie Murphy.
Yeah, what do you mean?
As far as at his age, Eddie is sharp as a tack.
No, I think something must have happened. Yeah, I don't know what it was. Or maybe he was just dehydrated that day because they were on a tour.
Question for you.
They've been working.
When you're famous, do you owe it to the public to tell?
I think that when you're famous, weigh in, fam, on this.
I think so.
When you're famous, if you're going to be in the public eye and do press like he did, I think that people love him so much. Like, who doesn't love Martin Lawrence?
Yeah.
Who doesn't love Martin Lawrence? And so when you see it, you are kind of like, what's going on? And does he owe us an explanation? I mean, not really.
I just think I would. I mean, we're kind of in the spotlight. I kind of let people know because, you know, anything different. Oh, by the way, I had that thought.
Hey, Cookie.
About, we had that conversation about Ozempic. I think at this point, if I took Ozempic right now, I probably wouldn't say anything until I lost weight.
Okay, so we were talking about, people come after these celebrities because they lose all this weight and they don't say anything. And then they're on, then they come out later and say, oh, I was on, you know, this weight loss drug. And then people get mad. Do they have to? That's a carryover from 2 weeks ago. Yes.
Kevin from Columbia, loving up on you, babe. So no, babe, not like a Red Table Talk. I was just loving up on you because as the whole world knows, you're a bomb ass chick.
Oh my
gosh. Allison, let me tell you something.
So much.
Bootsy was giving love too. Here's the thing, guys. Allison, we were doing bench press yesterday. So Allison is, if you know, she's petite. She's a little compact little Coke bottle. She's a shapely young lady. And Babe was on.
That's what I'm talking about.
Babe was on. Oh, first of all, and Babe doesn't like it when she thinks I give creeper vibes when I kind of.
Babe, now you're doing Red Table. Like, people are going to be super sympathetic and make me feel like I'm a jerk.
Babe on the bench press. Go ahead, Allison Seymour. On the bench press, y'all, with the bar for real, for real. Kevin said, I just sound creepy. Thanks, Kevin from Columbia.
Thank you. Okay.
Babe's on the bench press,
thank
y'all.
Thank you, Kevin.
And I was just like fired up because she had the bar going. That's, babe, you know, that's 90, that's 45 pounds. Handling it. You're handling it, babe.
That's 45 pounds?
Yeah.
Oh, I did not know that.
That bar is 45 pounds,
You got to be kidding.
Yeah. Well, that's Seymour's strength.
That's right.
That's Seymour's strength.
Cousin. All right, let's talk with Carl, to Carl with the K. So
Carl with the K is standing by. Carl, man, no time for us. Get the questions. Well, you didn't know that, baby. He's like, hey, y'all, here's four questions. I'm like, oh, right. Damn, Carl. Carl on these streets.
Carl, first of all, let me ask you this. One of the things I want to talk about later. Mm-hmm. But how excited are you about the Negro League stats being rolled into the MLB stats and these records? Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, gone.
And let me tell you
just like that.
The baseball fans love baseball so much.
And look, mm-hmm.
As much as they love it, they don't like to acknowledge
achievements.
Negro League baseball.
Right.
As much as they love Major League baseball, they don't like to acknowledge that very few Major League baseball players played in the Negro Leagues with the black players and mm-hmm. could hold their own. Namely, I think Dizzy Dean and his brother. It was Dizzy and Dazzy. It was like two funny names, Dizzy and whatever. And then Stan Musial in St. Louis. He also did.
Right.
He wasn't that great though.
Well, those were the ones that wanted to play against the best.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Right.
And all you got to do is think about it right now. Take out the black and Hispanic players and put them in the league and see what's left. And you can imagine the level of talent you're talking about back in the day.
Definitely.
How excited were you about that? I was so excited at work because we reported it on the show this morning. And what I love about it is it just shows, you know, it's little things like this that sort of show the excellence that was denied. And, you know, and there's room for everybody.
Right.
So move on over Babe Ruth and move on over Ty Cobb.
Here's something to make you think, right? So Satchel Paige was rookie of the year.
At 47. Right. Or however old he was.
They asked him a question like, if you were in your 20s, what would happen? He was saying, if I'm in my 20s, you should throw it like at rabbits and squirrels. Mm-hmm. He basically said, back then, I just hit them and they would explode. He was basically.
Now we don't condone animal
cruelty. 47 throwing heat. Imagine what he was throwing when he was 20.
Exactly.
Unbelievable.
Anyway, so I'm happy to see that level.
Yeah, it was awesome. Field. I thought it was really great. But I also know, and I don't have that part of the spectrum on my internet, but I know there's some heads exploding this morning and afternoon. Right.
And you know what? And it shouldn't be that way. So as long as it's that way, I'm going to be exuberant in the thought that these players are getting their due.
Look at Divya.
Yeah, I see you, Divya. Divya Gupta is with us, and she says, I sit on the board of a nonprofit founded by 7 living players from a Negro league. That's pretty amazing. And it's been a rewarding experience.
Every week, Divya has another.
Divya is so great. Divya is so great. Like, yeah. Okay, Carl, what you got?
Well, today, first of all, thank you. Welcome back. I'm glad to be back. I missed you guys for a couple of weeks. My first question is about your industry, the TV industry.
Oh.
TV executive Channing Nicole Dungey became the first Black American president of a major broadcast television network. When she was chosen to be by what network? ABC, NBC, or CBS? She's the first Black president.
I believe it was CBS.
You do? I actually have no idea. So I'll say ABC. ABC was my first job out of college was at the Washington Bureau of ABC News. And just because I worked under Carol Simpson, and that reminds me of that name. I'm going to say ABC.
Oh, you work with Carol Simpson. That was
I worked, what can I get you, Miss Simpson? That's what we're talking about.
Yeah. Right. I grew up in Jersey, and that was like my first news anchor, heartthrob.
Oh, she's wonderful. Did you ever meet her?
Never met her. Never met her.
A beautiful person. Okay, but what's the answer? Let me see.
You are correct. It was ABC. It was right around
Raymond was with you.
Yep. It was Randy right was around the me. Same time that Roseanne made her little comment about the woman in Obama's administration. She was the president of the network at that time.
Oh, so recent. This is recent.
Oh, yeah. Okay. She's currently, I think, chairwoman over at Warner Brothers Television now.
Oh, wow. She is heavy duty.
Yeah.
And the thing about, let me tell you, the thing about race, this is weird, especially with celebrities, is that these moments happen and they get dragged. But then, Roseanne Barr, I've heard so many Black comedians talk about how she gave them a shot. Mm-hmm. She was in a time when she was so powerful, So it is interesting. It's a very complex thing, isn't it? This race thing.
Right. I mean, it's a situation where you can do a bunch of good, but that one bad can.
One bad.
Can take you down. All right, let's go into the business world. True or false? This is simple. True or false? In 1991, BET became the first Black publicly traded company on the New York Stock Exchange. Is that true or false?
Okay, it became the first. Oh, Black.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
Black publicly.
I'll just say. I'm gonna because it's such a random fact. I'll say true.
Okay. I'm gonna say.
Say true with me.
Okay.
We say true, Carl. Final answer.
Final answer true?
Yeah.
Okay. Final answer is false.
Dang.
In 1969, Moore Park sausages, Mom, please.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Yes. In 1969, Henry Parks took Moore Park sausages public.
What?
And became the first Black-owned New York Stock Exchange. It took, and 20 years later is when BET happened.
I did not know that.
Wow.
Was it St. Louis? Was that a St. Louis?
No, no, Baltimore.
Oh, Baltimore.
That's okay. Baltimore. Yeah, and that was a funny thing. When I moved to Baltimore, Mark, I did not know Park Sausages was Black owned. I grew up with that commercial, grew up eating it, never knew that.
Which Ray Harrisburg was amazing. And you know how, we all strive for a legacy.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Harrisburg, always sharp, always kind. There's an organization. It's a business organization that has since maybe taken a turn to selfishness. I don't name the organization, but he was a part of it. And here was a man who, again, was a part of American history, mm-hmm. was a titan in the business industry. Mm-hmm. And this young man I met from DC, who was a part of that organization, he was saying, man, the only reason I stayed, and then when Ray passed, I left, was Ray Haysbert. Because Ray mm-hmm. Haysbert's goal of, in these organizations, I think, guys, we've seen this change. We saw this change in a lot of things. He said Ray Haysbert's goal was, I want to educate younger people on how to do business properly and mm-hmm. bring them up, mm-hmm. right? The organization turned into almost like, I got this, we got this, let's make money, right. and keep it with our, you know, let's keep the money within ourselves. And basically, if your business didn't, you know, generate blank $1 million, you couldn't be a part of it, and that mm-hmm. kind of thing. But I just love the fact that Mr. Haysbert, who, that was my impression, and of him.
I didn't. Yeah, I met him. He was definitely like that. He was very like, wants everyone to achieve. He wanted everybody to achieve.
Look at CL. CL smart. CL be hitting.
No, the Johnson Products came after. Sorry.
Whoa. Hey, CL, sorry. Oh, both chaired by Johnson's. Okay, go ahead. CL ain't gonna stop now.
Haysbert related to Denzel Washington Jr., the Allstate man, Dennis Haysbert.
No, I don't know. Wait, that's possible. Was, yeah, I didn't even think about that.
He looked more
fake Denzel Washington.
Oh, don't do that. We will not have that disrespect on this show.
Dennis Haysbert.
Okay. All right, last but not least, one more kind of business question, but we got a lot of females in sports. We don't talk about the women sports owners. Co-founder of BET, Sheila Johnson, is not one of the owners of which of the following professional sports?
Okay, I'm gonna have this one.
Is it Capitals, Washington Capitals, the Washington Nationals, or the Washington Mystics? She owns two out of those three.
Yeah, she is not a part of the Capitals.
I'm gonna have to rock with my girlfriend.
Oh man, I'm so disappointed. She is not a plus owner of the baseball team, the Nationals.
Really?
She's not owner of the Capitals, the Mystics, and the Wizards.
Brandy got it right. Hey, Brandy Marie.
She is part owner of the Capitals, the Wizards, and the Mystics. So she has a Stanley Cup ring. She mm-hmm. has a Washington Mystics ring. I don't think the Wizards have won the championship yet, so I don't think she has a ring from them yet.
Okay,
not yet.
Not yet. You know, dreams can happen next season. Well,
next season.
For the Wizards.
Yeah. Randy's like, I know my national. That's right. Randy's a big Nats fan. So
Randy's a big baseball
Yay.
Player fan.
Yes,
Sheila
indeed.
Johnson, a lovely person.
So once again, I want to thank you guys for having me this week. If anybody was out and about, I will be at TGI Fridays tonight at 7.
Carl's
I'll be
it.
In Arundel Mills. I'll be at TGI Fridays in Owings Mills tomorrow. And tonight, tomorrow, it's all about the movies from the 2000s. When I say 2000s, I mean 2000 to 2020. So I have trivia on all that behind the scenes, in front of the camera, and so forth.
I fed Carl with a K. I felt like, speaking of movies, I think a movie that's underrated mm-hmm. is the movie with Big Boy and Andre 3000.
Oh, Idlewild?
Yeah, I think it's underrated.
That was pretty.
Let me tell you something. Marc loves Idlewild. He at the time he made me watch the dance scene on Idlewild. I think you just have a crush on. Is it Paula Patton?
I didn't have you watch Paula Patton. I had you watch the dancing.
Why are you Paula Patton? I thought she was. I think
you might have a crush on Paula Patton.
I think Paula Patton's beautiful. Paula I don't Patton have a crush
in,
on her.
Paula Patton in that movie reminded me of the first time you see somebody that's going to be a star,
mm-hmm.
and it actually didn't turn out that way for her, huh?
Yeah, well,
it reminded me the first time I saw Mariah Carey, which was at Jack the Rapper in person. The first time I saw Whitney Houston.
Wow, you go way back. Jack the Rapper.
The first time I saw Mariah Carey, what's funny about music is, so it was at Jack the Rapper. Mm-hmm. And Mariah Carey was unveiled as a R&B, black R&B artist. Mm-hmm. She then morphed into a crossover artist. But I remember my friend, she was 19. Isn't that crazy?
Wow.
And Matola was in his 40s. Gross.
Yeah.
And my friend was like, man.
I feel like when I think of him.
He was like, man, yeah. Her man about to be rich. He was already rich.
He was already rich.
Anyway, but okay. Thank you, Carl, with a K. Always
have fun at TGI Friday.
Always great.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate you.
All right.
Have a wonderful day.
You too.
All right.
You too.
Kevin said that was creepy. Look at Kevin. Look, Kevin. You can't say creepy no more. Okay.
No, that was the old one.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. So let's get into this. First of all, let's do a follow up on your health journey because, man, it has been a journey so far. So back in February, I think it was February, right? Marc goes in for feeling some numbness on his in his legs and all that. It lasted for a little bit too long. So he said, I'm going to go in. And then next thing I know, you're on Facebook saying that you have a diagnosis of MS. And I think it was so much that it just helped for you to just be like, well, y'all, they say I have MS. And I was just like, what? And so you were hospitalized for about a week.
I didn't call you first.
No, I knew, but I didn't know if I was surprised.
Gave you my first call.
Yeah, I understand that. And you are mine. But I just, and then the second call is to the Facebook community. So I was like, okay. So we go through all this and then you were waiting for, so you kind of have to have that second follow-up to see exactly what's going on.
Yeah, you're diagnosed in the emergency room. It's not really like.
Yeah, so that was in February.
February of 2023.
2023. And then because you have to wait forever to get a specialty appointment at Johns Hopkins, which is where, you know, you wanted to go because they have, that's the MS center there. And, you know, Johns Hopkins is thought of as the gold standard and all that. So we waited. We just had this follow-up first appointment. Now some of that was because we had to
insurance.
Yeah. Insurance. And we had to change in insurance and all that, but ultimately we just went. So we're sitting there and Mark's getting all these testing, like they're doing like a strength, you know, can you push my hand and follow my, and all these different battery tests, right? And I was like, that seems weird, but and then you asked the question.
So is the diagnosis of MS confirmed?
No. They say no, it's not. It's something we don't know exactly what it is yet, but it's just such a, like, it's a roller coaster. And
yeah.
You know, those of you who know people, it's like everybody knows somebody that has MS. And so there are these, some flare-ups is what they call them. And you haven't had one, hadn't had one since back in February. So, you know, we're thankful and hopeful that maybe it was not the correct diagnosis, but right now we have to sit in the fact that whatever. So you've had the follow-up.
Yes.
Blood work and MRI. And
McDonald's just make me feel ill today.
So now because you ate too much McDonald's.
Too fast. I didn't eat a whole bunch.
Yeah.
So Brandy says, how do they test? Because I swear I have symptoms, but I'm scared to test.
Yeah.
Could it be diabetic? I was pre-diabetic. I've been diagnosed as diabetic. Then I was pre-diabetic. And then I was no longer diabetic after the weight loss surgery. It's basically, but Brandy, that's the thing. That's the tricky part. So how they tested me was they did three MRIs and then a spinal tap, and they found, so you're right, the neuropathy in the feet is actually, okay, Divya.
Okay, Divya.
Take care.
Good night.
The neuropathy in your feet, Brandy, that is a symptom of diabetes, and it can be confused. The thing that in the emergency room that made them believe it was MS was the lesions on one of my brain and one on my spinal cord. The lesions were the thing, I think the thing that sold.
So that's an MRI, Brandy. You have to do an MRI to find that. So,
I
need you, girl. Don't play with your health. Go and see what's going on.
Had a bad spinal tap when I had my baby. Mm. Well, you know, so interesting. That's the thing when you go into these, so today I had a whole bunch of blood drawn, a whole bunch. He said, I'm the second. I said, this is the most you ever had to do in a day. He said, you're second. And the other person passed out. But he wants to rule out everything, Brandy, because that's the thing. You know, the neuropathy is a symptom of many things. Could be anything. The lesions also could be, depending on. And so that's what he wanted to rule out. So I did a lot of blood work today to find that out. Then I'm doing another MRIs to see if there's been any changes since the last time. Because his concern was it looked like the two lesions occurred at the same time, indicating it could have been caused by something. So that's what he's looking for.
My baby don't feel good, y'all. He is, that GI check is kicking. I can tell. It feels indigestion, like you have acid reflux and all that. Yeah. Okay, we're going, okay.
But no,
so
okay.
So we're waiting to see. So that's the second.
Yeah, numbers in your feet.
Yeah. Brandy, somebody said I saw a post and it said, nobody rides for you like friends you've never met on social media.
and Brandy's face popped up.
I thought of you because.
Brandy said, maybe a small stroke you had.
Oh.
And Brandy, why did you say that like R2-D2? Yeah. No, you said it like
Yoda.
Maybe a small stroke you had.
Yeah.
No, he was asking, was there anything that happened? Mm-hmm. Interesting,
like,
Brandy.
Even like, were you sick? Did you have a cold?
Damn it, Brandy. That's a good call. I never thought about that. Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Okay, well, we'll find out and we'll keep you posted. Yeah.
Yes. Amen, brother.
Leave it alone. Okay, so let's get into some. Did you have anything you want to talk about? Because I have
a list
of things. When we were not with you last week, man, that's when like all the Diddy stuff broke, that Cassie tape. This was 2 weeks ago, I think. And you know, all that. And I was so sickened to see that tape and to know that Sean Combs had basically said, I'm tired of y'all lying on me and this and that. And then the tape came out and you saw him savagely beating Cassie. And then he comes back out with this apology. Now, what I will say about the apology is it felt like, you know, he was sincerely sorry that he got caught and now you come out and you whatever. But I felt like it was the most transparent Sean Combs that I've really ever seen. Like he seemed like, I have no doubt that he is sorry, but he wasn't sorry when he said she's lying on me, basically. But what did you think about that whole thing? It made me like feel sick in my stomach, like to imagine that and then see the other pictures of her with him on the red carpet and all that, and knowing what she was going through and thinking about what so many women are going through.
Well, like you said, I just think
it really made me.
Upon first viewing his apology, I did feel like, oh, wow, that's probably the most sincere I've ever heard him sound.
Yeah.
But then Joe Budden pointed out he did not apologize to his daughters and he didn't apologize to the women in his life. He said, that's a flag. I have to agree. Mm-hmm. That is a flag.
And then Joe Budden his ex-girlfriend came out and said, I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, you gotta be quiet. If you ever have a history of violence towards women, you can't really be talking right now. Don't comment. Don't say nothing.
But then, so she came out against Joe Budden, and then Joe Budden basically called her a liar right quick. So it's just, I don't know. You know what they say, was done in the dark.
And here's the thing about
comes out in the light.
Yeah.
Or
anytime a man says disparaging things about a woman, my flag goes up for me, because I think, no, I don't care what the experience was, that I wasn't raised that way. Mm-hmm. So anytime I hear that, and people are like, well, what did she do? That kind of conversation. It's always,
don't ask me what she did.
Yeah, that right there says something to me. And I just think that's how I was raised. I was raised by powerful, strong women who were respected. I never saw them be disrespected by a man. And so that's how I live my life. I don't do that.
Well, I feel
except
like
one time I disrespected you. Oh, I did not.
Lies. I just wonder what's to come. First, we saw that raid of his home. I guess that's where the tape came out, because allegedly he had paid $50,000 for it to go away, and then it popped up again. I guess he thought nobody was ever going to see it. You know, and he said he was disgusted by it, and he's disgusted that, and so are we.
And so are we.
So somebody said, I think one of the ladies on The View was like, I don't want to see you. I don't want to, like, please just go away, get yourself together, or do whatever you need to do. So,
So here's the latest, if we haven't checked in on, you know, this was in the Hollywood Reporter. This is crazy, right? Going back to Howard, where he basically apparently hit a woman with a belt. And this really, let me say this, sadly, being in the radio business, many of the moguls, I don't have to name names, you guys know I'm insinuating, many of the moguls had terrible reputations back then.
And we just let it slide. I mean, yeah. Diddy is not the first. He won't be the last.
No, they had terrible reputations
right.
back then on how they treated their workers, especially their women.
Yeah.
And it was just, shoot, program directors and radio had terrible reputation. It was a different world. I think TV was better than radio, right?
Well, they just said TV, you mean TV news?
Yeah,
because it was different. You're not trying to,
it was corporate. It was more corporate than radio. Radio was mom and pop.
And surely those stories exist, but yeah, it didn't necessarily seem to be like, you know what you got to do to get your whatever it is. So I think it was different, but I'm hoping that one day this can change, that it's not an accepted norm. Molly Ringwald, who was an actor back in the day, like in the 80s, all those films that we watched when we were kids, like that's our generation, like The Breakfast Club and all that. She just came out and said that, like, you know, she was never, she was never assaulted in a sexual way. Trigger right there. But definitely. She was like, I was street smart and I was able to get out of different situations. But definitely I had creeps all around me. And this is like, one of
creepy people. Too.
Yeah. And this is one of America's, sweethearts back in the day. It just seems so prevalent. And the sad part is these people are artists. You know what I mean? These people are artists and they're trying to get into a space that fame comes with it. And they're just trying to, and so many lives seem to have been, adversely affected by trying to get in the business. She says she has a 20-year-old daughter who also wants to be an actor. And against, she's tried to say no, but this is what she wants to do. So, I hope that we can see a day when this isn't the accepted thing from usually, sorry, but powerful men in positions of influence to be able to put you on.
Yeah.
Okay. So another thing that I wanted to talk about, speaking, let's flip it.
Flip it.
Powerful women.
Flip it.
So Lizzo. Have you seen this Lizzo story?
Mm-hmm. You want to see? I got the video.
Okay, should I set it up a little bit? So let me set it up. So South Park, right? You know South Park. She was mentioned on South Park because they were talking about something about Ozempic, right? And one of the characters, I forget who, basically said, don't worry, forget Ozempic. You need to get on this Lizzo drug. And the Lizzo, and they're a pretty brutal. I mean, if they parody you or whatever, you're just like, ugh. But basically,
no, Kevin, not Pepto Lizzo. Okay.
They said,
sure, that's what I need right now.
Oh, okay. So basically they were like, get on this Lizzo. It gives you basically self-confidence that you don't care. You're so comfortable in your body that it doesn't matter if you are, lose weight or all this, because you feel so great in your skin. So here's her reaction, having seen the episode.
Guys, my worst fear has been actualized. I've been referenced in a South Park episode. I'm so scared. I'm gonna blind duet to it right now. There we go.
I was telling you, Sheila, these new drugs are pretty amazing. I was feeling so ashamed of myself, watching Randy go out and exercise all the time and not eating as much. But I just don't have the same kind of willpower he has.
Which of the drugs are you on, Sharon? Ozempic? Mounjaro?
Oh no, I talked to my doctor. He said insurance would only pay for those if I had diabetes.
But if you can't afford them, then how are you managing your weight?
Don't you know, Sheila? Now there's a whole new obesity drug for those of us who can't afford Ozempic and Mounjaro. I've controlled all my cravings to be thinner with Lizzo.
Oh, oh, it's Lizzo.
FDA-approved Lizzo makes you feel good about your weight, and it costs 90% less than Ozempic.
I've lowered my standards and my expectations.
It's Lizzo.
In case studies, 70% of patients on Lizzo no longer cared how much they weighed.
I don't give two shits.
Lizzo helps you eat everything you want and keep physical activity to a minimum. Some patients report constipation while listening to Lizzo. Stop listening to Lizzo if you experience suicidal thoughts. Serious side effects may include pancreatitis, hypothermia,
what the fucking album?
Out your ears. Are you living with concerns of obesity?
Ask about the power of not giving a fuck with Lizzo.
Our next period. That's crazy. I just feel like, damn, I'm really that bitch. I'm really that bitch. I really showed the world how to love yourself and not give a fuck to the point where these men in Colorado know who the fuck I am and put it on their cartoon that's been around for 25 years. I'm really that bitch, and I'll show y'all how to not give a fuck, and I'm gonna keep on showing you how to not give a fuck. Oh, 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 Lizzo, bitch.
We're sorry. We should have bleeped some of that out.
They're grown ups. They're grown ups, okay. Baby. They're
but yeah, now some. Okay, now listening to the whole thing, some of it, of course, they're trying to be funny. Mm-hmm. But the bottom line, though, is like, live your life.
They're
right?
Gonna get you now. They live got Kanye. Life. They're gonna get you.
Live your. She was happy with it.
Yeah.
She was happy with it because the ultimate message was.
Oh, Dr. Long's on here. Wait a minute.
Oh, Dr. Long. Love L. You know, it's just like. Yeah, I'm going to live my life and I'm going to be happy. She was on the little carousel and all that. So what did you guys think about that? I thought that it was pretty, I thought it was pretty powerful. You know, there's some things like, okay, I don't care about this and that, but they're trying to be funny. It's a parody. The message being free yourself.
Free yourself. The rest will follow.
Free yourself. Okay. So, we should have done the little girl before. Should we not do that now?
I got her.
Okay. It's kind of heavy though.
We don't have all of it. I mean, she cusses, the little girl cusses at the end.
Don't, let's not show her. It's just, because it's so heavy. It's basically, let's not show her. You want to talk about it?
Girl, we need these ratings. I'm joking.
You want to talk about it? Okay. Well, pardon some of this language.
Well, she doesn't cuss on this one. She just,
But for me, what struck me is, and I should have put this in better order. The producer and me should have put the show in a different order. But yeah, her mom is being accused, I think falsely accused, right? Of shoplifting. And the little girl, she's really like riding for her mom. But for me, what really hurt me was all that pain and anger that she is expressing. How did it hit you?
Yeah, I guess it's almost like the kids, they pick up how we act.
Yeah.
So obviously she's been seeing this her whole life. But also it's just, I think it speaks to like the world. I think sadly the kids are exposed to so much video, so much of this. They see so much that they can't help but be a part of it.
No, but so for me, it felt like, so we're going to show to you just a little bit of it, and pardon the language in this one too. But so her mom is accused of shoplifting and the cops are there and somebody's recording it. And for me, just her basically having to take on the role of a grown woman. She's a little girl.
Yeah.
Having to take on the role of a grown woman and the trauma, and you can see the anger and frustration at this moment. So,
she had a Zara bag. The CV gave a description of a female black.
What classes did I steal from Montclair?
Mommy, I know who it was.
What classes did I steal? Thank you.
Stop recording it now. You should not.
So you can see just the level of the emotion,
yeah.
You know, that she has to grow up that fast.
Not a baby.
Not a baby at all. And she should be just a little girl.
Yeah.
But it's I don't know. I think it's just a reality for a lot of young women in the times that we're living in. She was scared for her mom. You could tell her mom was really holding back. But clearly when they did this description of the shoplifter, like I haven't seen what happened, the rest of it, but it didn't sound like her at all. Right?
Yeah, and you hear the description, she's like, it's a black. It's just like, man.
Yeah.
It's like this world, boy, I tell you.
Yeah. It made me, it hit me.
Watching us.
Right. It hit me because I think that our kids, if that had happened, I think they would have been more scared. They would, but she's a little fighter. And here's my hope. My hope is that she can channel all of that that anger that was right there. And that protective spirit, you know, maybe she'll become like the next great lawyer, you know, to defend people who are that their civil rights are being trampled on or whatever, because she has a lot of energy. And I hope that I don't know, feels like trauma. And I hope that it can be channeled into something positive because
wow.
Because she's a baby.
Yeah,
she's 10 years old. She's a baby. How are you feeling?
I'm okay.
I don't think so. Let's do one more topic.
We got to do Lenny and Gayle.
Okay, let's do it. Gayle, look, set it up.
Yeah, well, so this package you can see on the website, but Gayle gets a chance to talk to Lenny Kravitz, who's had an amazing career.
Yeah.
And let's all keep it real.
And I think like his new album, too.
I think we're in the same age group. When we learned that what's our girl? Lisa Bonet was dating this guy. Remember? Mm-hmm. He had another name back then, like Purple Blue something. Remember?
No.
And we were like, who's this loser?
What?
You know, because it was like, she's dating an artist.
To me, they were perfectly.
But it was like, who's this
perfectly
guy?
Perfectly matched.
Who's this guy?
Back in the day. It was like, okay, Lisa Bonet, this your man? Yep.
He turned out to be Lenny Kravitz. So now, as he heads towards 60, Lenny Kravitz, ladies and gentlemen.
When Lenny Kravitz walks in a room, you are the epitome of cool. You are the epitome of sexiness.
Right up top, Lenny!
And I'm wondering if, A, you're aware of the effect you have on people, or is this something you have to work at?
I don't work on it at all.
Are you aware of it?
And I don't think about it, but I am aware of people's reactions.
From the outside looking in, it seems like for a long time, you've lived your life with no apologies, live your life very authentically.
I do, but I still have these moments. You know, people look at you and think,
he's completely
got it going on and he's confident in everything he does. To some degree, yes, but then we all have our insecurities.
Lenny, I would love for you to share with me what is an insecurity you have personally and professionally. And I also agree that we all have them.
Mm-hmm.
But I am curious about what that means to you.
It means a lot of things, but sometimes I'm just not necessarily sure what it is that I'm doing. For some reason, I'm still that 16-year-old kid trying to get the record deal.
Really?
I haven't shed all of that. My family hustled hard. My grandfather, my mother, I hustled hard. I chose to leave home at an early age, hit the streets.
You're a teenager.
Yes,
yeah.
So I still have a part of that person inside of me.
Kravitz often thinks about his roots.
I grew up being a New York kid. I took the subway at a young age, walking with your friends, taking cabs. My mom taught me to be independent at a young age.
His mom was actress Roxy Roker.
Well, we're moving on now. To the side.
What do you think, Lenny, when you hear that theme song?
That song
do you know the theme?
Absolutely. That song brings me so much joy. Every time I hear that song, it lifts me and
does it?
Reminds me of being a kid,
yeah.
Going to see my mom film it.
Oh God, Tom, it feels so good to disagree with him again.
Before they moved to LA, Roker would send Kravitz to an after-school program at Harlem School of the Arts. The school has since grown, but it began in this church.
I can't believe your mom would let you get on a bus from East Side to here.
Mm-hmm.
And you were not afraid?
Not at all.
Wow, Lenny.
I loved it. I loved coming up here.
Lenny Kravitz coming through. I guess you got good knees.
Oh, wow. This is the room.
Lenny, yeah.
It is a trip.
So you first learned to play guitar in this room?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Think of that little boy now. What do you think about him now when you look at, because now you're considered one of the greats. And back then you were just a little boy learning the guitar.
You know, I'm still learning.
Are you?
Never stop. All I can do is really just feel how blessed
you are,
you know, and how beautiful the journey has been.
In many ways, the journey is just getting started for this rock star who turned 60 this weekend. He says he's in the best shape and place he's ever been.
As you sit here at 60, do you have hangups about that? Are you
Not
worried
at all.
About it?
Or? I don't trip out on age.
You don't.
At all. I don't understand the concept. And for me, look, you can be 30 years old and be destroyed, and you can be 90 years old and be young and vibrant.
I feel that too, because I'm 69, you know? And people said, you shouldn't tell people your age. I don't want to be hung up that, oh my God, I can't say it. Lenny, I'm so happy to be here on the planet.
I think it's more impressive.
I don't know about that, but I just want to, I feel so happy to be on the planet.
Healthy.
Healthy, exactly healthy. So I was wondering if
and gorgeous.
Well, thank you. It takes a village. It takes a village. As you sit here turning 60, when you think about that, do you feel I'm ready? Do you have apprehension?
Ready for?
Whatever the next chapter is in your life.
Well, I have no choice. So you know what I mean? Like,
oh, that's true.
Either you're here or you're not. Here's what's interesting. However this sounds, I've never felt more young. We got to let
love rule. You said let love rule. Asking for a friend, is there love in your life now? Do you have a significant other in your life? And can I beat her ass if she is? Oops, did I say that out loud? Do you have and I'm nonviolent, Lenny Kravitz. But do you have a partner? Do you have love
right
in your
now
life?
I'm just open.
Are you even looking?
It's hard not to look. You know, when you desire something, you know, you're looking for it, right? But I find that when you don't look is when you find it. And I'm at a place where I've said this for several years. I'm ready. I wasn't ready. I thought I was ready, right?
But now are you ready?
I can say that I've never felt how I feel now.
I'll just say this about you. You seem very comfortable in your own skin at all times. Mm.
I think that's a constant journey, but I feel great. When somebody says, when did you feel like whatever? You know, yeah. When did you feel your best? That I have to go, oh, let me think. Let me see, man. No, today, right now.
Today. That's how I feel, too. Here's to us, Lenny Kravitz.
That's right.
Get it, Gayle. Gayle was surveying. Those knees. How are your knees? Hey, Gayle had her little boots on. Gayle had her boots on, baby. She was ready.
So my main thing with all that, the thing that hit me, yeah, we love Lenny Kravitz. And his album is really nice. Because you played a couple of cuts for me that I like. The part that was cute for me was... when she was basically asking about the love in his life. And then we see, like, when I think about Gayle King, she's such a journalist and she's so whatever, but she was like, when she was like, do you have a love in your life and can I beat her ass? That was hilarious to me because it's so out of character. People, you know, trip, but it happens when I'm in circles and I'm talking to people on this little tiny scale that I'm on. And if I were to say something, and I usually apologize if I, you know, curse or say something like ass or whatever, but it's funny because you don't expect it. So
you're funny. Gayle's not really known to be funny.
Oh, but she was funny that day. So
she was
okay.
Funny and had her little boots on. Gayle said, let me jazz it up.
Look at Brandy.
Get jazzy.
60. It's, you know, the older that I get, the more I do look at people in that are older than us. And I'm just like, okay, yeah, we can do this another day. So Gayle is 69 years old.
Oh my God. Gayle's damn near 70.
She looking amazing. And so does Lenny. So yeah, I love that. All right. The last thing that I had to talk about today was this Alfonso. How do you say his last name? Ribeiro?
Yeah.
Alfonso Ribeiro.
Yeah.
It was weird. Did you guys see this? And what is the bad beef between him and Tyler Perry?
So on X, somebody said, Now this is kind of, maybe we're just offended.
Do you have the tweet?
I don't have the glass.
Oh, okay.
I just have
it
over here.
Okay.
Somebody said, Tyler Perry needs to revamp Alfonso's career. I just know he could.
Yeah.
So the person who wrote it's thinking he's saying something positive.
Yeah.
Alfonso's response.
Like, way too strong.
Says, I don't need or ever want that man to do anything for me.
Huh?
Damn. So what's the beef?
What are people saying about that comment?
Well,
what's,
you know, X is a crazy world. Nobody's. What do you say?
I don't know.
What was,
like,
your reaction to that?
Maybe they had some former dealings, and he was trying to hire him on the cheap, or said something, or maybe he feels like his movies or whatever aren't up to par with whatever he's into. I don't know. But I was just like, what is all this vitriol?
Are we reading too much into it? I don't think so
because
I don't want that man to do anything. I don't ever want that man to do anything for me.
Yeah.
That seems like a lot.
I just wonder what's going on? What's the story here?
What's going on?
So, yeah. Those are just some of the things that I was like, "Oh, I can't wait to talk about this with my
Let love rule. That's
my
the
family
theme.
Here.
The chat didn't even comment. Y'all ain't saying nothing.
About the Alfonso?
Yeah, you're like, oh, whatever.
Because we don't, like, it's so random and weird. You don't know, right?
Is that it? Oh, excuse me.
Oh, my bad. Look.
Let's call him an ass.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
You know what's funny? I know what's happening. I now know what's happening. Okay. I asked the guy about, you know how...
You need to eat because you had... Come on, let's go get you something to eat.
No, I'm full. No, the problem is I ate too fast.
Let's get you some orange juice.
Yeah. So what happens
is... Sugar's low.
Yeah. He said what happens... I asked him about the vagal response, like people passing out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, obviously you don't rock with him. But why? Like, why is the reaction so strong? To go to social media and basically, yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah, no, yeah, he's Alfonso. It was a child star. He's the tap dance kid. He did his
He's saying, how dare you, basically.
I guess he's
been in this game forever.
Yeah, but why? You? But you don't say, like, yeah. You know, Tyler Perry is a great talent. I don't think it's really my thing, and so I'm good without it. But yeah, it sounds like something else, actually. I don't know what it is, but it's weird. I guess I would never go on. He knows the whole world is going to see it. And it's just sort of a strong response.
Yeah.
That's what struck me. I was like, what's going on? Does anybody know? So, all right. So what are we going to do to make you feel better today?
Well,
you just need to lay down.
I think so. Brandy said she's going to do some digging and find out.
Okay.
Oh, wait a minute. Tio said something happened at a Diddy party.
Oh, that's ugly. Okay, so yes, he is.
No, so the guy I asked,
he gave a lot of blood. He did a lot of blood.
My friend Troy has the vagal response, mm-hmm. passing out when you get blood.
Mm-hmm.
And I was asking the guy about it, and so he was explaining. I think that's kind of he was saying that your sugar's low, the anxiety, the combination makes you react a certain way.
Okay,
and pass out. Some people and get you had sleepy. Meeting. Some people get sleepy. Mm-hmm. So I think it's somewhere in there.
Okay. Well,
the amount of blood taken, mm-hmm. and then the body's he was saying your adrenaline. When your adrenaline is cut off, it makes you feel sleepy. Okay. So that's probably the way.
Well, we're gonna figure out.
I know you guys do not care about that.
We're gonna figure it out. I'm gonna take care of. Yawning again, y'all. So, okay. We're sorry that we were not around last week. I had so many things to talk about. So I think I monopolized the conversation this week, but,
we're together. We're a team,
but, so many amazing things. Of course, in the real world, we're awaiting the jury gets the Trump hush money trial. I think they said Friday they start to deliberate. They wrapped it all up. So in the real world, that's happening. That's a big thing that's going on. And I don't know. The question has been asked of reporters when we spoke with these correspondents in New York. So what does this mean? So ultimately, what happens if Donald Trump is the first former president to ever stand trial, like a criminal trial?
Yeah.
And so what does it mean? I think for the folks who rock with Trump regardless, I don't think it's going to mean anything. And so if he's still allowed to be the presumptive Republican nominee for president, he's still going to be the Republican nominee, and people are still going to vote, and it's still going to come down to it. So meantime, I think Biden's writing checks to folks trying to, you know, writing checks, he's forgiving loan, college loan debts. He's trying to do everything that he can. He's opened some oil reserves so that gas could be cheaper. He's pulling out the stops. So we'll see. The election is in November. Vote.
Biden is paying for free cookouts.
Yeah, he's speaking at.
He said, "I want to be invited to the cookout, Black Americans. So I'm paying for the cookout." Take that idea, Joe.
That's the biggest thing. Of course, this war in Gaza still rages on. It's we're seeing more protests around the world. So we understand big things are happening. But this man is tired. We're going to go. And we'll see you next week. If there's some things you want us to talk about, you know.
Let us know.
Safe space.
And Ask Allison's always around.
Safe space. And we can talk about it here.
All right, y'all. Peace out.